Boys and girls, do you want to hear a true story? Saturday night was at this real live party. They had the liquor overflowing the cup, about five, six strippers trying to work for a buck. I took one girl outside with me. Her name was Tyler. She went to junior high with me. I said, "Why are you up in there dancing for cash? It's been almost a week since we've had this cast." And he said, "What would you do if your boys were at home recording a podcast all alone because they're hungry? And the only way to feed them is to sleep with a man for a little bit of money." All right, we're good. I should start preparing. Cody, do the ad reads, please.
Episode 61 is brought to you by our good friends at Waterfront Docking LLC, as well as Waterfront Industries. If you own a lakefront property around Lake Madison or the greater Madison, South Dakota area, and you own a dock, boat lift, jet ski lift, anything of that nature, and you need help with installation, removal during the seasons, or you need any parts, pieces, equipment, you can always feel free to reach out to the Waterfront Docking LLC boys and girls. And if you specifically own a boat lift, you should head on over to waterfrontindustries.com and you can check out the lift ski. It is a very cool product that attaches right to the bottom of the boat lift, and it makes it a very easy two-person job to move it in virtually any direction over any surface. So, like I said, if you have a boat lift, definitely go check it out. That is waterfrontindustries.com for the lift ski stuff. And for the lift skis and all of the other things, you can always reach out to Jim and the team at 605-270-9426. And episode 61 is also brought to you by Raise Energy and repsports.com. Actually got an Apollo Raise Energy
Ooh,
right here.
Apollo.
Yep, it's
That
got
thing's got to be full of sugar, right?
no, actually
Oh, what?
zero sugar, zero crash, full of electrolytes, BCAAs, that's branched chain amino acids, I believe. I guess that's good for you. So,
Yeah, I
boom.
love branch chains. Those guys are really raising the bar.
Oh. Okay.
Yeah,
Oh.
we've
All right. Yeah, but yeah, cool can, cool design. Very patriotic. It's got the Lady Liberty right here. But
my
yeah,
favorite lady.
if you are testing the waters on a new like zero calories, zero sugar, energy drink, feel free to check out Raise Energy. That's RAZE. And you can check those out at repsports.com, and as well as repsports.com has a bunch of other supplements, pre-workouts, sleep aids, all sorts of stuff. So you can head on over to repsports.com. That's REPPSPORTS.com. And if you use promo code PREMIX, PREMIX, you can get 15% off at checkout. And with that, let's get into it.
Bam, 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 bam. My plums. Oh, what's up with you, man? How's it going? You look great. That hat's awesome.
Thank you. I got a bunch of merch in, samples of the new stuff that our VP of visualizations and brands put together. So usually mentioned at the end of the cast, but since we're talking about it now, if you head on over to tcthepremix.com/merch and check out all that stuff. We have some stuff. We have some yoga pants for the ladies, and mostly or men. I shouldn't.
How dare you assume?
That's on me. Yeah, a lot of the merch. There's like some unisex stuff, but then we do have more labeled as male sizes for wardrobe stuff, just because. I got a feeling a majority of our audience is males, but hey.
Yes, we've seen the stats. That's why we're putting stuff at the beginning of the podcast now. You guys need to listen all the way through. Don't tail off in the middle. I know that's normally where we lose a lot of you, right in the middle. Or sometimes I go off on little rants all the way through.
Also, I think sometimes it's hard for people to find some of our stuff. So I tried this, like, have you seen like a lot of influencers and different content creators, they're starting to use like Linktree.
Yeah. It's on Instagram and stuff. It's very, very popular. Very easy to use.
So I made us a Linktree. So if you're familiar with Linktree, you just type in your URL or your search bar, linktr.ee/TC the Premix. And it'll bring you up to a navigation page that'll take you to like our Twitter, Instagram, SoundCloud, Spotify, and it'll take you to our homepage. And I just took you directly to the merch, because essentially our webpage will give you a link to get to like Spotify and SoundCloud on there as well. But I figured if you were going to go to the webpage specifically, you might be just going there to look for the merch. But
and don't be left behind this summer, folks, where everyone's going to be allowed outside this summer. Don't be walking around not wearing a Ripping Throats TNC Premix shirt. You're going to look dumb. Everyone's going to make fun of you. And when people ask you what it is, don't be afraid to scream our social media handles and stuff at them. Maybe make them listen to an episode. Yeah.
Oh, I was going to say capital M-A-C. Let me spell it out for you. Because if you don't know what Ripping Throats is, it's too late for you.
You've made it far too far in this podcast. Well, you weren't on mute on that one.
That's my bad. yeah, I'm still sick. Shout out for being sick.
How was moving that piano?
It wasn't bad. Our VP of visualizations and brands, I'm not going to assume his weight, but I think Colin is probably like 100 pounds less than me, but very, very strong man. And I think lesser two men, I don't think, would have been able to move that piano, because we moved the piano and then we did have some help from the previous owner lifting it into the back of Colin's pickup.
Ah, yeah, that's smart. Pianos are known for being light.
Yeah.
No ramps, just straight raw dogging it.
We just raw dogged it, and then we raw dogged it out of there, and then we raw dogged it down the stairs. Yeah, I'd say like we probably should have thought about it a little bit more. We didn't have all gas,
no brakes.
But honestly, like there were a couple times where like my legs almost gave out, and I thought we were gonna drop it. But we fucking got it. Colin's a very, very strong man. He's like trained like MMA and like different things like that. And he's like lifted weights and played sports like the whole time. But like, he's just like a leaner cutter. It's funny that like, he's probably legitimately 100 like less pounds than me, but he's like very, very fucking strong. So like,
It's well known to be in our like coaching tree. Like if you're around us, you have to be strong. Like that's just one of those things.
I keep not using my mute button.
It's why we installed them, but
sorry, that's my bad. We didn't hoist it 10 stories and drop it on anybody, so that was kind of a bummer.
Kind of lame.
But
did you bust on any tasty licks on it?
Funny story about that. So Colin's wife, Kirby, shout out.
What's up, Curbs?
She came along, and like the people that we were buying it from, like I walked in and there was a piano here and a piano here. And I was like, ooh, this is a two piano household.
Not a household I want to be in.
And this guy was very much like a cultured, definitely wants his kids to study the arts. And you know,
oh yeah, I think I'm looking up the definite fucking nerd.
And got his ass. He like looked at me and he's like, you play? And I was like, yeah. I was like, I can play Twinkle Tick a Little Star or Mary Had a Little Lamb. I can even play a little bit of We Three Kings. And Kirby said she like looked at him like when I said that, and he was like trying to figure out if I was joking or if I was being serious, but I was being dead serious. Like I can play anything with single keys, but you start touching multiple keys at once.
That's wizardry. I don't trust it. Get your fancy fingers out of my face. That's
yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah, it was a good time. Actually, wasn't bad. I was really fucking sore though.
Oh like, yeah, that's like just you talking about hoisting that piano into the truck made my back twinge a little bit. And I know we don't like to brag about playing through injuries. Cody's sick. My back hurts a little bit. You know, I grind. I put it on the line.
Like I was like trying to like walk it off, like, oh, it wasn't that bad. And then like the next day, Colin's like, hey, low key, I'm really fucking sore. I was like, yeah. Me too.
I'm just picturing you in like a 1920s style, like iron lung, just laying there, just being like, yeah, no, I'm totally fine, but I understand if you're sore.
Like it was really weird. It was like, I don't know, forearms up through the biceps, like somehow like my upper back shoulder.
Those are the only muscles I work out. Forearms, only biceps, middle of my back. I'm going for a real weird look.
Yeah, it was, I felt like we did good. We didn't break anything that I remember. So don't look too closely at anything in your house, Kirby.
Just you get done lifting it and like, wow, we didn't break anything. You just knock a lamp over.
There was a point where we were going down the stairs and it kind of like, we about put her into the wall and that would have been bad, but we got it.
Oh, every time I've ever had to move anything heavy in my life, which besides my body is a lot, because people see me and they're like, it looks like you would love to lift some couches up some stairs, which I never would. But every single time it's like, hey, be careful. And I'm like, yeah, I understand. Don't break things. Inevitably end up just smashing a wall with like a corner of a couch. I'm like, yep, there it is.
I think there's like a certain point, like if you're lifting something really heavy and awkward, like everybody just comes to a mutual understanding.
But enough about my wife. Oh.
Everybody comes to like a mutual understanding that they're like, something's going to get broke. Like,
yeah.
Or like you get to the point where you're just like you lost your commitment to like being careful. You're just like, all bets are off now. We're tired.
Yeah, that's annoyed. 100% me.
We're just going to throw this around. We're just going to ram it through the doorway.
I'm not pivoting at all. I'm cramming. That is moving help. Like having me help move is you get 20 minutes of actual like help where I'm like informative. I'm actually lifting with proper form. If it goes on past 20 minutes, I'm breaking shit. I'm carrying far too much. I'm dropping things constantly. And that's the Tyler Johnson experience. You're just going to have to deal with it.
Yeah. All things considered, we did a good job. I'm proud of us.
I'm happy for you too.
We are men. I think I talked about, 23andMe on this before, potentially.
We talked about genealogy and stuff. You claim to be Dutch. I almost ended the podcast.
Oh, I don't know if I'm Dutch.
You're Danish, Dutch. It's all the same goddamn thing. You goddamn filthy tulip breeders. That was probably incredibly insensitive against the Dutch. I just refused to care.
It's weird because like I remember checking my 23andMe, like I guess must have been back like in around March or something, like when we first started doing this podcast. I remember talking about it, and
I said I'd never do it because I'm not a government stooge. They'll never have my DNA.
Yeah.
Pretty normal conspiracy. Pretty normal for conspiracies like me.
They already had mine. Law enforcement.
They took
it from me with force. So
they do have my fingerprints. Those rat bastards. I got to get rid of my fingerprints now.
Mine was only, they only took it from me so that they could determine if some of the blood on a crime scene was mine. So, but it's totally above board.
Everything's
no
cool.
Funny business.
Yeah. I was not charged in the murder of those three midgets. That's fine. I was not actually implicated.
I think like last time, it's weird. So like this 23andMe, it's like as more people submit their DNA, like it constantly changes all the time. So like right now I'm like 45.6% French and German somehow.
Ooh, that's
when I don't think I was. Huh, we will.
Yeah, we will. Oh.
Je m'appelle Hugo Jacques Trois-Ans.
You're saying that a little too fluidly for me. I don't like it.
And I guess now like I'm only like 31.4% Scandinavian, which is like Swedish, Danish,
Norwegian,
Finnish.
Shout out to our Finnish boys.
Shout out. And I also noticed that I don't think I was this before, but I think I am 0.4% Italian. So Marron.
Ooh, Marron. That's why you love the Sopranos.
That's why I have like three Gumas. So hopefully Lily's not listening and she doesn't watch Sopranos. So she doesn't know what a Guma is.
It's boom roasted. Burn. Does this mean, can I claim this so I can just start eating gabagool out of the fridge in my robe? I will do that if I can start doing that.
Dude, like I said before, when like Tony's pulling like sheets of wax paper, like covered things out of the fridge and just eating meats in front of the refrigerator.
Oh, I identify with that so much.
Yeah.
Except mine's actually just a bag of shredded cheese at like 3 a.m. and I'm just shirtless, like a bear.
But like the whole reason I brought up the 23andMe is like one of my second cousins, like connected with me on there, and like we kind of know each other, but we only see each other like every 4 years when there's like a whole family reunion. But yeah, so that was pretty cool.
Bring him on the cast. Let me bully him. Or her. I don't know why I assumed it was a dude.
It was a he. He's a little prim and proper. I don't know if you would appreciate some of our crude.
Yeah, joke. But
like the crude things you say.
Oh, just me. Listen, did I talk about, I have a very fun story that involves poop. And yeah, if you can't get behind that story, get out of my life. That's cool. I want to do that, but I just don't. I don't think I have the. I don't think I really want to get tested. Because yeah. I don't want to come back and be like, you are 96% Canadian, and like 4% French, and I just gotta hate myself.
Yeah, or like, there's like a potential match, and it's like, this is your daughter, and you're like, damn it.
Easy.
I'm just saying, hey, could potentially happen. I mean, hypothetically to me.
Listen, and as soon as DNA tests get better, I'm done with DNA. I'm out. I don't want it anymore. Oh, man. I don't know if you could tell in the Zoom, and I know people listening certainly can't, but I'm growing my mustache out. Yeah, that's what I want to do. I want to be able to curl it, and I'm pretty close. But, man, did you ever learn how to, like, trim your mustache?
No, I do. Yeah. I comb it, and then I just trim it, like, at an angle around my lip line like this.
Okay, yeah, see, that's more than I knew. Like, I'm going to have to start doing that because I'm starting to get a lot of scragglers in the old mouth.
Yeah, you'll have that.
Not a fan.
Yeah.
But I am a fan of me curling my mustache.
Yeah. If you once it grows out a little bit longer, you'll eat a few of them from time to time.
Yeah, no, I've got one on like this side of my face that I've just been chomping on. But it's also a little bit more like, I don't know. I gotta work on my mustache, but I'm pretty excited about it. That's a good look. See, I want that look.
Yeah, see, great audio. Just us playing with our mustaches and looking at each other.
Touching our facial hair and staring at each other.
Oh, boy.
But all right, let's talk about a couple important things, such as that you and I both had a little bit of a mental breakdown when I figured out that yesterday, Tuesday, the 26th, was the one-year anniversary of our dear friend Kobe Bryant passing away. If you would have told me that was 4 months ago, I would have believed you. And if you would have told me it was 2 years ago, I would have believed you. Holy hell. It's been a year. That seems like yesterday almost.
Yeah, it just doesn't seem like it was that long ago. And like the only thing I remember when COVID like first started, like starting was right about that time as well. So yeah. it's because I remember somebody like posted an article and like the main page was like Kobe, like remembering Kobe Bryant. And then like on the side column, it was like,
COVID, should I be worried?
small outbreak in China. Yeah. And it's like, nobody cared. Like, and like to a small degree, like, I think that was like, honestly, part of it. Like if that hadn't happened, like that was like a big focus of the news, you know, like that was a big, big deal. And like the whole COVID thing was developing at that time. And our attention was obviously focused on that to a degree, but yeah, I can't believe it's been a year.
Yeah. That just blew my goddamn mind. I was just like, wait, what a year? Are we sure?
R.I.P.
R.I.P. A big R.I.P. to number 8, number 24.
Mamba.
Just a year. Goddamn, dude. Time is weird. I'm not in on time. I'm not in on time, and I'm not in on DNA. Those are just two things I'm not in. I don't want it. Fuck time. Oh, yeah. Speaking of time, my spine just hurts. I'm going to live forever. I know exactly when it started to hurt too. It was like Monday and I like moved a little bit weird and I felt the twinge in my back. Boom. Had to foam roll for 2 hours just from moving.
Yeah. It's, my neck has been jacked up like ever since I turned 30. Legitimately, I think like on the day, like I woke up and my neck was just like,
oh, well, so I saw an ad for one of those things, like the posture corrector things. And I was like, ooh, that actually looks like something, you know, maybe I could use. Like I tend to get a little slouch going on. I probably don't sit up straight. Looked one of those bad boys up. No, thanks, man. Those are expensive. And then like underneath it, they're like $199 for a good one. But then I started reading some like reviews. People are like, oh, this is such a scam. Like it's not like, that's not actually good for you to be like strapped back in like that. I was like, oh, so now I'm just going to work on my posture naturally, which consists of like 4 times a day, me just being like, ooh, I got to lean back.
Is that when you were looking at them, was it just like the strap that kind of like tightens you up? Or I've seen like the ones where like, in the center of your back, there's like a sensor and it like senses like at what angle it's at. And it'll actually like sync up to like your smartwatch or your phone or whatever. And it'll tell you like, hey, your posture's not good.
Lean back. I was looking at the ones that were actually strapped, 'cause I thought they kind of looked cool. Like I had gun holsters, but those are expensive. And then the sensor ones, I was like, yeah, there's no way I'm going to listen to that. You don't control me, computer. I control you. But yeah, I'll work on my posture naturally. By that I mean I'll ignore it until it kills me.
But, that's fair.
Yeah, that's I don't know. Posture's weird. Bodies are weird. I didn't win. I was hoping one of us would win the huge lotteries that happened. Neither of us did. Because first thing that's going on the list, chiropractor, that's going to follow me around. And just constantly be like, hey, why don't you, and then like lean back a little bit. Because I'm never going to do it for myself. That's not how I roll.
Yeah, it was kind of a bummer to find out that I wasn't going to be a billionaire. Kind of a, you know, but life goes on. Were you with Lance watching the fights? Were you?
No, Lance blew my party off for probably a way dumber party.
I just remember I saw like the board with all the bets for like all the fights or whatever. Or allegedly there was some things scribed on what appeared to be a big board. I don't know. I mean, it could have just been something else.
Clearly. You'll never know. Because that's illegal in this state, unless you're in Deadwood. Or if you drive a border into Iowa.
But I was going to say, so the big one, the, you know, Dustin Poirier upset Conor McGregor with a technical knockout. Just destroyed him with the calf kicks.
Yeah, hard pass on that. That's where I really decided getting kicked in the calf would be not cool.
And like, I guess one of my big takeaways is like everybody's like, oh, Conor's a chump, Conor sucks, like Conor's terrible. But like, it's just like Conor has gotten away with. Like, if you notice, like he fights in a wide stance with his lead hands lead
forward, hands down, trying to bait you into punching him in the face so he can punch you in the face.
And it works. And honestly, like if you rewatch like the start of that fight,
it was working. It was effective.
His move is come out early, pressure you, get you on your heels, smother you, and just hit you, and you know, and then usually like he'll get people to cover up and he'll just lay it on him and knock him out or push him up against the cage and hit him with a couple shoulders.
That shoulder move is very effective. I think more people should adopt that.
Yeah, he was doing like shoulders and like the foot stomps. Like you push somebody up against the cage, you start stomping on their feet and hitting them in the face with your shoulder. Like
I'd be upset.
It's something that a lot of people, you know, probably don't train for that specifically, I wouldn't think. I mean, I'm not an MMA expert, but
I remember the first time I saw John Jones like throwing devastating elbows, and I was like, what the fuck? Like you can punch someone with your elbow? And then when I saw Connor do the shoulder thing against Cowboy, I was just like, wait, you can punch people with your shoulder now? Like that doesn't seem right.
Your entire body is a weapon.
Yeah. I was impressed with Connor. And then as soon as like I saw him getting kicked in the leg. I've seen a lot of leg kicks in the UFC. I didn't realize that he was like, that's like a legit game plan. It's like, oh, I'm going to take away his leg.
Yeah. Like, I've seen, you know, like front, like leg kicks and stuff depending on the style of fight, like it's very effective, but I've never seen like such a devastating, like that part of the calf that he was specifically his
targeting.
He was throwing those kicks and he was almost like wrapping around and getting inside high calf contact. Like, yeah, that was wild, but good on him. Dustin's, you know, well, I think what they said, like he's fought like however many more times within the last 7 years since they fought.
It was crazy. It was, I know I don't know the exact number, and I know we always get roasted for making numbers up, so I'm not going to, but yeah, it was just like, oh yeah. And also Connor hasn't really he had a 40-second warm-up fight with Cowboy like a while ago. And then he was just hopping back in against arguably one of the top fighters in that weight class. And yeah, he got punished. Did you see like the after picture of his leg? It looked like he had like a football. Like that's how much it was swollen.
Yeah, I didn't actually look at the pictures, but I did listen to like the the post-fight press conference from Connor, and he was like, yeah, he's like, I have an American football tucked inside my my suit pants right now.
And an American football, you cheeky bastard.
And I will say, like, Connor was like, I mean, there's not a whole lot you can do when you get beat like that. I mean, you just got to kind of suck it up and take it. And good on him. I mean, he was gracious in defeat, as cliche as it is to say. I mean, he handled it well. He pretty much, you know, said that, you know, Dustin was the better man that night and he deserves it. And a lot of people like saying like Connor's a chump and like he's washed up and he doesn't have it and all this and all that. Like, you got to realize that lightweight division is a lot different than it was like 7 years ago. Like, there's a lot of talent in that lightweight, like, Oliveira, Gaethje, if Khabib decides he wants to come back, Ferguson, Cowboy, like, there's a lot of there's a lot of talent. I'm sure I'm missing people because I'm not as
my brain don't work good.
But yeah, I mean, it's a stacked division. I will say, I did not on the co-main, the Chandler Hooker. Like, I think when we talked about it on last cast, like, I didn't realize who Chandler was, like, coming over from like Bellator or Strikeforce or whatever.
Strikeforce, yeah. I say I kind of talked about it, but it was one of those things where it's like I'd never actually like seen him fight. I just knew that he was good. I didn't realize that he was absolutely like, I will body bag you type of good.
And like Chandler and Hooker are also like two guys in that lightweight division as well. Like, they're also very good. And Hooker, like, you know, got caught and knocked out, but like, he's also like a decorated striker stand-up guy as well.
And he got outstruck by a person who was considered like one of the top elite wrestlers, which I was listening to an interview, I think Monday, with Chandler. And he was talking about, he was like, the guy was like, well, you're known as a wrestler. Like, what made you like so good at having a stand-up game? And he's like, well, you know, like, he's like, I knew I was good at wrestling. He's like, so I decided to focus more on boxing. And when I started boxing, I figured out I had lightning in both hands. I was like, wow, that's a cool thing. Like, it's like, I was really good at that, but I'm also really good at this. And then he called out Khabib, and he said a pretty cool quote where he's like, yeah, Khabib wants 30-0, but if he fights me, he'll be 29 and Chandler. I was like, ooh, he's going to kill you, but I'm kind of curious now. I have a very simple lizard brain. Like, if you make me entertain, I want to watch that fight. Like, I would say, like, even like, that's why, like, well, even like watching Connor fights, because like we had a group of people over, socially responsible, we were all distanced to watch the Connor fight, and like just like the hype leading up to it was just like, yeah. Like, that's worth paying the money for, to get like that, get like a group of people together and have like excitement.
So kind of similar to like how Chandler came over from Strikeforce or whatever. I guess I'm not familiar with him, but you said it was Strikeforce.
I'm pretty sure it was Strikeforce.
Like, how, so like Ben Askren, who like fought in one, like, O-N-E, and then also was in Bellator, and like he came over and like you know, obviously like his debut was against Masvidal, and he got
did not go great
viciously knocked out with a knee. And then I think he had what, like, he only had like one more fight. I think he fought Maya.
For some reason I thought maybe three, but yeah, two sounds also right.
And he lost, he got submitted it in the third round. So like after so after Connor lost, Jake Paul shows up and starts talking shit about how he was offering $50 million to fight him, and he's like, now I got 10,000 for it.
10,000, me.
So it looks like it's slated for April 17th, excuse me, this year. Ben Askren
and 17th.
Shut your mouth. excuse me. Jake Paul and Ben Askren are going to have a boxing match on April 17th, excuse me.
So I looked at I saw that. I saw that they immediately had betting odds and that Jake Paul was the favorite. He was like minus 270. And I was like, whoa, that's kind of weird. I didn't realize that Jake Paul is like 3 inches taller and like 30 pounds heavier than Ben Askren. And Ben Askren is literally known as like, he's like a wrestler, like even in UFC in two events. Granted, he got knocked out in one of those events in 7 seconds. Like we said, by Jorge Masvidal's knee to his face, top of his skull, actually. But he like didn't even land one significant strike in the UFC. Like he's a wrestler. That's what he's known for. And then I also saw, because in my dumb brain, I was like, oh, dude, I'm definitely going to take Askren. He also got his hip replaced like 3 months ago, and he hasn't trained since he lost that last UFC fight.
Oh.
So that's tough.
Also, real quick, correction. I forgot that he choked out Robbie Lawler. That was actually Ben Askren's debut.
So he
was against Robbie Lawler. Three. Yeah, Robbie Lawler. Jorge Masvidal was when he got viciously knocked out. And then Damian Maia, he lost by submission. So he is 1-2 in the UFC.
Hey, well, that Jorge Masvidal, that was a goddamn train. So I think that broke him in a lot of ways, the Masvidal knee, both spiritually and mentally and physically.
Spiritually. But put him in the spirit world.
Yeah, he did send him to the spirit world. But like Ben Askren's not a puncher. And so when I was reading about the betting odds, because once again, I had to talk myself out of being dumb. They were just like, yeah, the only way he's going to beat Jake Paul is if he just out cardios him, which he's really like, he's a wrestler. So wrestlers have good cardio. I think Jake Paul might win this one. And then he's going to be like, oh, fuck, pussy MMA fighters. I beat the shit out of them all the time. And then he's probably going to run into some sort of horse-like MMA fighter and get murdered.
Yeah, I feel like I'm definitely going to watch the fight or, you know, try to watch it. But yeah, I mean, to make it be a boxing match, I would say, I mean, granted, Askren has, you know, several years of MMA training, but like you said, like he's a wrestler, grappler, you know, jiu-jitsu guy. He's not known necessarily for his striking. Granted, he's more than capable and has training in doing that. But yeah,
he'd beat the fuck out of me.
for Jake Paul to call him out, yeah, it's kind of funny.
And also, like, Conor McGregor still made, like, $18 million off of losing on UFC 257. Don't act like Conor McGregor is, like, some scrub. He's still, like, the most famous person you could get to fight besides maybe Floyd Mayweather. And Floyd Mayweather is going to assassinate Jake Paul's brother. So that whole, I don't know what their strategy is by calling out people trying to beat them up. That's just, but when we have the podcast fights, which I'm not working out the details, but when you and I tag team another South Dakota podcast, that's going to be awesome.
Hopefully it doesn't go past like the first 30 seconds. Cause I will.
Oh yeah. No, we got to win. We got to win them quick. I'm really working on a strategy where you throw me like a board and I land on top of them. And I just basically lay there.
Could be effective. Not to bring us down, but I was going to talk about the Chad Wheeler thing. That guy is a trash human being,
psychopath who should probably be in jail. It might already be in jail.
Yeah,
probably in jail, definitely in jail.
Yeah, was it? I guess I had the story pulled up, but was it his wife or his girlfriend?
I think girlfriend. I'm not totally sure. I did not have the story pulled up. I just saw the story like earlier today.
Girlfriend, I think. Just girlfriend. But yeah, so on the 23rd, Wheeler was arrested on domestic charges. And like right here, it just says like for choking his girlfriend. But I saw the picture.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure he like dislocated her arm. He bloodied her face. And I guess like he choked her till she was unconscious. And then she told the cops that when she like came to, he's like, oh, you're still alive.
Yeah. Like came, they was like eating like food and like drinking a smoothie. Like, oh, hey, thought I killed you.
Yeah. And then so like she ran and barricaded herself in the bathroom, called 911. I guess he broke the door down to the bathroom, like, and luckily cops got there in time. Yeah, I talked about this in one of a group chats, one of our like fantasy football leagues. We talk about like all the NFL stuff, but yeah, I guess supposedly they're saying like he has like he's been diagnosed with bipolar disorder and he was off his meds and all this shit.
But yeah, so I saw the tweet, and I was like, it was someone being like, let's see. What Chad Wheeler is accused of doing is absolutely sickening. If true, F that guy. I hope he goes to jail for a long time. I saw that and I was like, who the fuck's Chad Wheeler? So then I looked it up and I was like, okay, I kind of know who Chad Wheeler is. And then I saw like the pictures and like the story. I was like, oh, so Chad Wheeler plays for the Seattle Seahawks, I believe.
Yes. Yep. He did anyways.
Did, yeah, he used to. But then I saw underneath the tweet, they had the tweets from Chad Wheeler saying like, because people are like, well, we don't really know what happened. And then it was three tweets from Chad Wheeler. Like, events happened over the weekend that transpired from a manic episode. I'm deeply sorry for the pain and suffering that I've caused to Aaliyah and her family. I apologize. And then he was like, it's time to walk away from football. I need to get help so I never pose a threat again. It's like, yeah, dude. Yeah, you do.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I don't know what the stats are. I'm sure there's a lot of people that have been diagnosed with bipolar disorder. Probably, I wouldn't say, I'd say chances are not 100% of them have attempted murder on someone. So that's far from an excuse.
And there's a significant difference between me and like, oh, that normal guy had a manic episode, kind of freaked out, normal size. And then like an actual NFL player just losing his mind, just being like, holy shit, I didn't kill you.
Yeah. And it's a little bit different when it's a 306-pound, 6'7" man. Like that is a murder machine.
Yeah.
And also like, this isn't the first time that he's had like violent like outbursts. Like back in 2015, when he was at USC,
USC scum school. There's a little fact for you.
The LAPD, I guess arrived and they said that he was under the influence of drugs and alcohol. He was punching walls and windows in an apartment.
Terrifying.
He had injured his hand. He ran out. He was ignoring the, commands of the police. When he's confronted by the police, like he, like tried to go back into the apartment and they thought he was going to grab a weapon. And so the cops like shot him with multiple beanbag rounds and then subdued him. But yeah, like it said he was with his friend and her 7-month-old son at the time. So like,
ooh, that's a potent recipe for disaster.
Yeah. So, I mean, like he's obviously, this is not the first time that something like this has happened. And, you know, granted that was like 6 years ago, but it doesn't matter. You know,
that's a pattern that you can't have. And like you said, 6'7", 306 pounds. That is a murder machine. Multiple beanbag rounds. No fucking thanks. If I'm a cop and I shoot someone with a beanbag round and they don't drop immediately, I'm calling back up.
Yeah, I'm jacking a couple of buckshot rounds into that shotgun. Yeah, and let him have it.
There is no way. Let's get him. So this is 6'7", 306 pounds. I, right now, as of 2 hours ago, am 6'4", 241 pounds. If you shot me with a beanbag round, I'm going to throw up and lay down. Not continue to be like, hey, don't do that. No, I'm done. You tased me. I was tased in a fun way a couple weeks ago. and just someone touched my arm with a taser, and it affected me for like 2 hours. Like I couldn't grip things. So anytime people are just like, oh yeah, yeah, he fought off some taser rounds, couple beanbags. No, nope, live ammo. We're going big game hunting.
Yeah. And I mean, like, so the guy, he came into the league in like 2017. He was undrafted, went to the Giants. And he, I think, like, realistically, like, from like 2017 till now, like, he's only played in like played major snaps in like only like 20 games. He was like on and off practice squads. And they said he was like injury prone, but also had like off field issues that I guess never got reported out, but the team was aware of. So yeah, I mean, nobody's going to miss this guy.
Welcome.
He needs to get some help, obviously, but he should be locked up and not allowed to ever do anything like this again, obviously. So
very, very true. Well, let's change the mood. I'm going to start with a bit of sad news, and then we're going to talk about some fun news.
Okay.
A little bit of a compliment sandwich. So today, March 27th, good God, May 27th, January 27th.
We're time traveling.
Yeah. Today marks 28 years since a little man named Andre the Giant passed away.
Little man
named Andre the Giant. So I saw that little fun fact, and I thought, hey, Andre the Giant, that's kind of right up our alley. A man who was, I was doing a little research on his height. They had him billed at 7'4" and 555 pounds. I consider that a bit of an embellishment. That they say closer, he was about 7 foot and 400 pounds, which is still an absolute tank of a human being.
Yeah, same with that big.
Yeah, I was gonna say, I mean, I'd kick his ass, but I had to. And when I hear Andre the Giant, I think of Andre the Giant drinking stories, because he's a little bit known for being a bit of a booze hound. And when you're that size, I think probably everyone's seen the picture of Andre the Giant holding the 12-ounce beer can. I don't know if have you seen this.
Mm-hmm.
If you're listening to this and you haven't seen it, Google it so you have a little bit of basis to go off of. But I looked up Andre the Giant's amazing feats of drinking, and here are six of the best ones. All right, number one, when he quit drinking, he still drank 5 bottles of wine a day to get down to a trim 475 pounds. 5 bottles of wine would put me pretty close to comatose.
Yeah, and that hangover would be brutal. Oh, yeah, wine hangovers are not good.
Here's a little fun story about wine hangovers. A sponsor of this podcast and I went to a Friendsgiving where we said to ourselves, it was, you know, Friendsgiving, people are going to be playing slap in the bag. There's going to be boxed wine flowing. We were like, hey, let's avoid boxed wine hangovers. Let's drink UV cherry mixed with liquid ice, because it kind of comes out purple, kind of like wine. Spoiler alert, I got in a fist fight that night. Did not have a lot of recollection of it. Not great. I did win the fight, I believe. Mostly because I don't think the other person knew we were fighting, but he also apologized to me. So who won, really? And also, if you've never woken up in a basement of a house you didn't know with bloody knuckles and just being like, ooh, that's not good. And then just scrolled through your phone to a bunch of text messages being like, what the hell? Oh, dude, I'm sorry. It's like, ooh, gotta get out of town. So that was fun. So Andre the Giant, good. He once rang up a $40,000 bar tab. So when he was in Princess Bride, I've heard of Princess Bride. I've never seen it.
It's pretty good.
Pretty good. Pretty good. I've always been told
it's,
that.
It's like a classic. You know, you think of it as like a classic. Like, you're probably not going to sit down and watch it right now and be like, wow, this is a masterpiece, because it's old. And
yeah, I do hate old things.
You know, it's, because of that, it's kind of like corny to a point and kind of old, but it's a classic.
Every time someone brings it up, I'm like, oh, I've never seen that. That's what they're like. Oh, you've got to watch it. It's a masterpiece. And I'm like, no, I don't. But when he was filming that, he rang up a $40,000 bar tab at the Hyatt in London. According to the interview with Carrie Ailes, I looked up who that was. It's the guy from Robin Hood Men in Tights. That's how I recognized him. I don't know how to say his name, but Andre's to-go order was something called the American. It's 40 ounces of various liquors poured into a pitcher. Carrie Ailes said, "I've never tasted airplane fuel, but I imagine it's very close to what it must taste like. It's very potent. I remember coughing a lot, but to him, it was like chugging water. He would drink six of these a night." Oh my God.
I think it's funny that they call it the American. We are gluttonous, gluttonous bastards.
What if we did something that's really bad for you, but we made it huge? It's like American. Nailed it. There is 33 and a half ounces in a standard 1 liter bottle. So that's drinking six of those just casually, or seven, like six or seven of those. That's a lot of hooch. Mm. If you gave me six bottles of liquor and we're just like, you have to finish these before you could leave this room, I'm in that room for at least a week. At least. So good for him. Now, this is where we start to get to some crazy facts. He once drank 119 12-ounce beers in 6 hours. That's a 12-ounce beer down every 3 minutes, nonstop for 6 hours straight. And after he did that, he passed out in a hotel lobby. And they had to cover him with a piano tarp, piano cover. So that's a lot of beer.
It's, yeah. Wow. I'm just like, that doesn't even, like, it's hard to even comprehend. Like, that's a lot of pee. That's what I think of.
Oh, God, that is so much pee. That's me. I might as well be drinking those beers in front of the urinal, because I'm
like, that's one thing I think of. Like, when you like, say hypothetically you're in college and you're playing a lot of drinking games and you drink like 20 beers, like, that's a lot of pee. If you pass out and you're drinking about 20 beers and you don't pee before you pass out,
you're making pee in the bed or couch or futon or your friend's hamper or your dishwasher.
Just imagine that hotel lobby, like how many mops they probably had to bring in there.
it's like in Big Daddy when the kid pees the bed. He's like, it can't be that bad. Goo!
I like peed the bed.
It's like 2 inches of standing water in the lobby. So you got to wear your muck boots.
Oh, man.
Now, this story is from our personal friend, the nature boy, Ric Flair. Let me get a woo.
I was going to woo a little louder, but kids are sleeping.
Yeah, mine too. But him and Andre the Giant had to fly to Japan from Chicago. And Ric Flair and Andre the Giant drank the entire 747 completely dry of every bottle of vodka on that plane. I don't know if you've ever been on a plane and have seen the absolute like carts and like pantry full of booze. That's impressive. And I know the nature boy has a history of overserving himself in drugs, alcohol, women, Rolex watches, alligator boots.
Tanning beds.
Yeah, a lot of tanning beds. But that's impressive. He drank, Andre the Giant drank a case of wine in 3 hours. That is 12 bottles of very powerful, very strong French white wine. Yeah, that's insane. Oh, and to go back to that 119 beers in 6 hours, once again, hypothetically, me and a sponsor of this podcast decided to sit down one fine Saturday and see how many beers we could drink. And I'm an American. I am gluttonous. I remember I drank 28 beers in like 15 hours. And I don't think I moved for like 4 days afterwards. I think you were actually there for that.
It's possible.
So I remember we bought individual cases And the sponsor and I sat down and just really got after it, basically just sitting there listening to music. And I remember getting very blurry. Now, this last one's my personal favorite. This is from the wrestler Bobby the Brain. Awesome name.
Not familiar.
Either am I, but it makes me think of Pinky and the Brain, which I like.
Or like Hanging Brain or the Bat Wing, like in Waiting when they show their nutsack to each other.
Oh, yeah. I was just somewhere. I think I was somewhere on Sunday and someone made a show him the brain reference. And I was like, now there we go. There we now we're talking. Another friend of the podcast, when that movie came out, we were in high school. And obviously it was in vogue to show everyone the goat, the Abraham Lincoln, the Batwing. This large calf fellow was showing people the goat one night. And we were outside of a female acquaintance's house. And he accidentally showed the brain to, not the brain, the goat, to this lady's mother. And I laughed and I laughed. Now me, I'm partial to the Batwing. That's I like to show off. That's my personal favorite one of those. But while these two, while Andre the Giant and Bobby the Brain were in a hotel in Kansas City, Missouri, they were approached by the bartender who said, is Andre the Giant with you this time? And Bobby the Brain said, no, he's not. And the bartender said, oh, thank God. Last time he was here, I gave him last call and he didn't want to leave. So I told him he could only stay as long as he was drinking. According to the bartender, Andre the Giant retaliated by ordering 40 double vodka tonics, and he drank them until 4 a.m. Good Lord. That boy is a horse. That Andre the Giant.
Like, my brain can't even process that. That's just.
Oh, that's just death. That's just death for me. There's just no, I just couldn't even imagine. Just the thought of seeing 40 vodka tonics in front of me, I'd be like, what do you want me to do with these? Fill a bathtub? But while I was looking at the famous drinking stories, I read another article that was just talking about funny stories from Andre the Giant being a giant. And they said that they would go to Japan a lot, like those old wrestlers, and like wrestle in Japan, because I guess American wrestlers were huge back then. But they had a picture of Andre the Giant sitting in like a plane seat, and he's taking up a whole row and he's sitting there. It looks like a full grown adult sitting with a bunch of preschoolers. Hilarious picture. But then they like in the caption, they said when Andre the Giant would go to Japan, the toilets were too small to support him, so he would use the bathtub. Oh. And just the visual of like a Japanese maid just walking into Andre the Giant's hotel room and just like walking in and seeing what happened to the bathtub and just walking out and being like, I quit. I quit. Just, I'm not doing it.
Yeah. I remember like watching like a documentary
on HBO.
I can't remember where I saw it. I don't think I watched the entire thing, but I remember seeing like clips of it, and like we joke and like these drinking stories are funny, but like the life of Andre the Giant was kind of sad, because like he drank a lot because he was like uncomfortable around around people. Like obviously, like he was used to being kind of like a freak show. Like people would see him and be scared, like children would be scared of him and like stuff like that. So like he drank to like just like try to deal with all that.
Yeah. And then so it said, when I was reading the article, it said that, and also that he was just in tremendous pain all the time. Like his joints were just like exploding constantly, and his back was so fucked up from being that big. And it's like he was drinking literally to numb the pain of that. Because even in the article, they were like, yeah, he's drinking all this. Every single person said he was like never drunk, or like wasn't like acting drunk or anything like that. Like when he was like drinking all this before, like going on like movie sets and like wrestling and stuff, they're like, he was literally doing that because like pain pills didn't work on him. It's like, well, that's fucking depressing. Also, he was only like 46 when he died. Like in the pictures of him, he looks a smooth 800 years old. Like you could tell that man, that man's head, his body was too big.
Yeah. He lived a hard life. His, just like existing, being that big, not to mention like jumping around and doing crazy things in a wrestling ring. All professional wrestlers that have done it for a while, like
except Dwayne the Rock Johnson.
their backs are all, you know, they all have injuries, their knees are fucked, their backs fucked, their shoulders are fucked, like everything's fucked, and they're not 500 pounds.
Yeah. I couldn't even imagine doing some of that shit and like, oh, you gotta get up and do it the next day. It's like, no, I have to go to the hospital. like my ankles have left my body, I don't have knees. I couldn't even imagine. Yeah, I have a little bit of a twinge in my back, and I'm like, fuck, should I call into work? Like,
I'm done. This is it.
I'm not kidding. It's a twinge in my back. It doesn't impede me. I just get up a little bit slower. I laid on the floor for like 2 hours on Monday night on a foam roller, like just being like, ah, yeah. If you told me I had to get up and run and jump, I'd be like, oh no.
I'm out.
Yeah. Yeah. It's just, Andre the Giant's just one of those like just fascinating studies of like, wow. So that's what humans shouldn't be like because that's just too big.
I would say like he, like of the small window of time that like people walk the earth, like Andre the Giant's got to be like definitely in the top 10 of like the most rememberable or most notable people. Like he was just a wonder of a person. Like he just,
yeah, I think
hard to comprehend.
Did, yeah, like even like if you like go to like an NBA game or like something like that, like the people you see on TV, you're like, wow, they're pretty big. Standing next to one of those people in real life who's like 7 foot tall, like it's like, holy shit. Like you're not even the same species as me. Like I remember Yao Ming, like 7'6". I lost a bet one time because I was like, I'm like, Yao Ming's skinny as shit. I'm like, there's no way he weighs more than like 260 pounds. And I think it was against T Freed. And he was like, Yao Ming, easy 350 pounds. I'm like, no fucking way, dude. And I pulled up a picture. I'm like, he's skin and bones. Yeah, he was 340 pounds. I'm like, oh, like he's 7'6". Like he's massive. I think there was some study done a couple of years ago where they are like most recognizable people on the planet. And Shaq was still like number three just because he's huge and he's on every commercial. Because if the check clears, Shaq will endorse anything.
I love Shaq though. I love Shaq, and I love how they pair him with Charles, and they just rip on each other. Or that time that Charles just nailed Shaq in the head with that egg. good times.
Shaq and Charles, instant must watch. We were like a couple of years ago, because when they do like NBA on Christmas Day, Freet and I were watching, and it was like 2 a.m, and you could tell those boys have just been done with like they just done NBA broadcasting for like 14 hours. And Shaq got up and tried running, and he fell into a huge Christmas tree. I laughed for like an hour straight. Just this huge refrigerator of a man falling into a Christmas tree just broke me. Just delirious. That is good times. I just can't even imagine being that huge. That's just a recipe for pain. What else we got?
I actually don't have a ton left on my list. I was gonna, I guess, recap the championship games. We're obviously not going to give our picks for the Super Bowl. And also forgot, like, the Pro Bowl, I guess, is happening, right?
No idea. I don't think they're playing it. I think they're just like announcing Pro Bowl of players.
Oh.
I think that's what I saw. Which, it's the Pro Bowl. Like, no one ever really watched it.
Yeah.
I took some great naps while the Pro Bowl was on.
Actually, I think I remember. I remember hearing something about that. That makes sense. Like, if there's anything that COVID is, I'm okay with them taking. You can take the Pro Bowl. That's fine.
It's like, you guys, we're gonna lose the Pro Bowl, and everyone's like, okay.
they still do that?
Yeah. Why are they in trouble? We probably should have discussed this precast. Should we save? No, we really can't. We should talk about. Let's talk about that.
I guess there's a lot of joking about fading our picks. I guess if you faded our picks,
congratulations. you picked right that one time. I don't think either of us expected the Green Bay Packers to be soft soy boys and, you know, not ever try.
Yeah, what they Tom Brady did his best Jameis Winston impersonation and threw three picks and three touchdowns.
Hilarious.
The Green Bay Packers could not produce, like, could not score any points off of those turnovers for whatever reason.
Ted LaFleur was just like, oh man, if only we had Aaron Rodgers. And Aaron Rodgers like, dude, I am right here. And he's like, I guess we just gotta fucking hope for the best. And Aaron Rodgers like, dude, please, I'm telling you, I can do this. And then Ted LaFleur is like, I guess
who the fuck's Ted LaFleur?
Ted LaFleur is a guy from Madison. Matt LaFleur. Fuck. I definitely just doxed that dude. Oh, my bad, Teddy. Ted LaFleur, Matt LaFleur. Fuck.
Same last name. I knew where you were going with it. I was just like, you said it the first time. I thought it was just a mistake. Then you said it the second time. I was just like, who the fuck is Ted LaFleur?
Yes. So everyone forget what I said during that last part. Replace the T word with Matt. Matt LaFleur.
Yeah. Yeah. Buccaneers beat the Packers 31-26.
I fully expected the Green Bay to win that game still until like the end of the game.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was just like, oh, I mean, there's still time on the clock. There's time for Aaron Rodgers to go down. Also, Matt LaFleur kicking that field goal.
So soft. Impossibly soft.
I understand. Putting points on the board, but like in that situation, you know, you're giving the ball back to Tom Brady. Like, there's two people that you don't want to give the ball back to. Well, I'll say three top people that you probably don't want to give the ball back to, like within or getting close to the 2 minutes. Aaron Rodgers, which is on your team, so dodge the bullet there.
Yep, nailed it.
You're probably not going to want to give it back to Russell Wilson because he's a comeback king. Don't want to do that, but also don't want to give it back to fucking Tom Brady.
Tom Brady,
that was the guy. Okay, why do that?
I'm sure he had like written down like his coaching sheet, and he's like, "Well, Russell Wilson's not here. We're definitely not playing Tom Brady." And he looked up and saw Tom Brady, and was like, "Fuck, no way." I know hindsight's 2020 and all that shit, but goddamn, play to win the game. Like, it seems to me like coaches, I don't know if they get too deep in their own head or what, where they're just like, well, yeah, like you said, like, oh, just put points on the board. It'll be fine. Dude, like, play like you're not fucking scared a little bit. Like, even like worst case scenario there where they kick that field goal, it's like, even if Aaron Rodgers doesn't fucking Aaron Rodgers it, you've got your defense has got them pinned within what, like 5 yards? Like, trust your defense a little bit.
Well, that's kind of like,
like, you're already trusting them if you kick
exactly.
the field goal.
Exactly. Like, that's what I was going to say. Like, if you're like, okay, if we're going to trust our defense, we're going to kick the field goal and hope that our defense can hold them, you just go for it. And that same confidence that you had for your defense holding them is it's now giving you a shorter field if they do hold them. Or, you know, at least like, controlling field position, they obviously would potentially punt or whatever. But, like, yeah, like, just.
You're already doing the hard part. Just go out there and let them play.
Like, you can't, like, there's no saving anything at that point. Like, you're not holding anything back. You're not keeping anything into the tank. Like, you need to win the fucking game.
Yeah. And that's like, it's like he was playing. It's like, oh, we'll get him next week. It's like, no, you're done if you lose. And that's what I didn't understand. And I really thought the Packers were going to make it. I know our large friend, our large cat friends watching the Super Bowl with me. So I was very excited for that because there's no way that wouldn't end with at least someone crying, probably me. But I don't know. It sucks because I really thought the Packers were going to do it, which we both took the Packers. So, yep, if you faded us, you're 1-0. Congrats. You cheered for Tom Brady, you front-running bitch. Sorry, I didn't mean that. I did.
Yeah. And
then, yeah, that game was upsetting.
Yeah, and then the AFC game, the Bills-Chiefs. Chiefs beat the Bills 38-24. I think everybody can agree that us picking the Bills was a hopeful pick. Yes, it was definitely picking the dog.
Yeah, we were using our hearts, not our brains.
But yeah, after watching the Browns play them tough, I figured the Bills, you know, could do a slightly better job. And Tyreek Hill is just
so goddamn good.
Something you can't account for. Like, just that one play I think he ran, it was like he ended up doing like 71 or 72
yards. 71 yards. 71, yeah.
But they probably didn't account for like, I'm sure they probably did do the stat or whatever, what the actual yards were, since he was running like horizontal.
480 yards, I think, roughly. At like a world record pace.
Yeah, that guy is just like he'll cramp out his body just because like he just exhausts his body to the point where like he can't, like he gives it everything that it has until like he just like collapses on the ground, and like then they lift him back up and hit him with some oxygen, give him a couple IVs and fuck, put him back out there. Like you are the weapon we need. You can run faster than everybody.
Yeah. He's so fast, he makes other people look not fast.
Big fan. That's
like, we were watching that like happen. Like he literally caught that ball. It's like, oh, he's trapped. Oh, he's trapped. Oh, he's gone. Oh, he's gone. Like it was like the emotions going through was just like, well, that was a good play. Holy shit, there's no way he can do that. Holy shit.
Like I can't remember the like the safety's name, but like as soon as he made that
Jordan Poirier, I think. Poirier. I don't know. It's not Dustin Poirier, but it's P-O-Y-E-R. Poirier. There we go. Like, I was thinking way too hard on that one.
Yeah, I couldn't remember who it was, but like as soon as Tyreek Hill made like that first cut, he just immediately turned around and took like a pursuit angle that was like 30 yards down the field. He ended up making the tackle, but like he knew that he wasn't going to try to like rush in and miss the tackle. Like he just planted his foot, looked away from Tyreek Hill, and just ran 30 yards down the field at.
Yeah, like it's like if he would have picked 29 yards, he would have been short by 55 feet. Like, how much of a pursuit angle would you have to take to catch Tyreek Hill? I don't think it's possible.
Probably like start from one pylon and run to the other pylon.
I don't know if I could do that. I might have to go half pylon. I might have to start in the middle and hope. Because also, he changes direction so fucking fast. Because that's, I even said that when we were watching the game. Like, he caught it and like his hips were already going the other direction. And like, just that like motion of the body, if I tried to do that, I'd break something. I would definitely
split in half.
Yeah. Like, I'd rip my pants, I'd fall down, and I'd like probably puke. Like, there's just nothing. I was just like, holy shit, there's no way people can do that. Also, can you imagine being like that NFL safety? He's probably one of the fastest players on the field. And he, even as soon as he knew, it's like, I have to time this perfectly or else he's going to make me look like an idiot.
Yeah. And I mean, essentially didn't make him look good either, but at least like that wasn't like a 80 yard touchdown. It was only a 71 yard run or catch and run.
Excuse me. I was disappointed in that game. I was kind of hoping Buffalo would come out with a little more sauce. See what I did there, Buffalo sauce. But like, it's, I don't know. They never really seemed like they were even close to being in the game. I think it was one of those things. Like, also the Chiefs can just fucking turn it on.
Yeah.
Very not fair. Reminds me of a young Dallas Cowboy team.
Yeah. I don't know. I mean, the Chiefs are just, they're just playing better. I mean, everybody kind of, I guess, kind of thought the Chiefs would do well, you know. I don't think everybody thought they would necessarily repeat.
Which is very hard to do in the NFL.
People say that, yes.
I'm the one who says that. No one else. Okay. Yeah, it was just me.
But yeah, so slated February 7th, Super Bowl. It's is this also the first time that a team has hosted?
Yeah. Because the Vikings had a chance to do it a couple of years ago. We all know what happened there.
Losers.
way to lose, nerds. But yeah, this will be the first year. I see there is a petition to take the Buccaneers, like their pirate ship. They're like, that's home field advantage. You got to take the pirate ship out. I hope they do. Tom Brady needs no edge in this fucking game. I've seen how this game plays out. I saw it with Peyton Manning. I don't like it.
I don't know. It'll be interesting. It'll be interesting for sure. I wonder if AB will be back.
Probably.
Because, you know, he was out.
Save that for the Super Bowl precast.
Yeah, sorry. I was starting to kind of get into it.
Silly us.
Yeah.
We have
some to think about. Also, we'll have a couple weeks to determine if he will, in fact, be back. Stay tuned.
Time. But I think I have no idea what time we're at, but I wanted to finish this podcast by telling a poop story.
The floor is yours.
It's not a TNC podcast on a little bit of poop. So Sunday night during the Bills Chiefs game, I decided it was time for a fat Sunday. Ordered a pizza, got some pasta, got some tacos. It was a goddamn feast. Me and intern Taylor enjoyed it. We were watching the game. We were having some laughs. My body was not prepared for that. So that was Sunday night. Ate healthy Monday, worked out, had not made a bowel movement still. That was Monday. Tuesday comes around. I have also not made a bowel movement. I ate healthy again, back hurt, but I was staying with it. Did a little bit of movement outside, got the body sweating. So Wednesday, AKA this morning, comes around. I woke up probably an hour before I normally do. So I was like, God damn, have some coffee, have a little bit of Tyler time. So I drank coffee, drank about 64 ounces of water on an empty stomach, and went to work. And about 10 in the morning, I was like, oop, there's the rumbles. Like, well, let's get this train rolling. And it just did, the timing didn't work out. And so at about 3:30, I was like, oh, we're about to have a major emergency. And I was like, I'm going to go home for the day. And my boss was like, yeah, whatever, leave. Like, you don't do anything here anyway. I was like, cool, see ya. And it's maybe a 6-minute drive from where I work to my house. And I knew, I was like, I'm like, this one's going to be cutting it close. I need home field advantage for this one. Like, I need maximum comfort. If I need to turn the lights off, put some soft music on, like, I need home field advantage. So I am racing home. I'm going like 45 and a 30. I'm not stopping. I'm got my back like arched, so there's no pressure on my ass. I am racing home. And like, there was about two instances where I damn near had to reset the counter. Like if someone would have pulled in front of me and I had to brake too hard, I have to get a new car. Like, that was, there is no way I could have salvaged the situation. So I turned the corners. I can see the TNT dojo. I know there is safety 100 yards away. So I fucking whip into my driveway. I get out, and the sweet old people that live next to us, or drive by, and they pull into the driveway, like behind me as I'm getting out of my car to run to the door. And they're like, "Oh, hey, Tyler, blah, blah." They said something, and I was like, "Oh, like I am straining. Like I am like just a single tear is falling out of my eye." And I'm trying to be polite because they're nice old people. And they said they were like, "Oh, they're like, oh, we're heading away this weekend. If it snows, would you mind doing our sidewalks?" I'm like, "Yep, that's no problem. Like, please." They're just like, "Oh, yeah, that's no problem. I got no problem." I'm like, "I have to run inside. I have to take this phone call." And they're like, "Oh, yeah, no problem. Have a good day." It's like 3:34 at this point. I have raced home. I am in tears. I ran to the bathroom. I'm not kidding. If I was wearing button fly jeans, I wouldn't have made it. Like those things, they were around my ankles as I was stepping into the bathroom. It was a fucking nightmare. Oh my God. It was one of those where I got done and I was just like, oh. I'm walking around great. That might have been why my back hurt.
Well,
it was a good Conor McGregor had an American football in his suit pants leg. I fucking almost cracked porcelain with an American football. And that was me almost pooping my pants.
Yeah. Well, I guess the story had a happy ending. It would have been funnier if you wouldn't have made it, but,
I wouldn't have told the story.
Oh, okay.
That would have came out in therapy in about 12 years. Cause there is no goddamn way I would repeat that. You guys would be like, "Didn't you used to have a silver key?" And I'd be like, "No, I actually had to get rid of it. It burned down." Like, "Weren't you wearing jeans earlier?" I was like, "No, I was actually wearing sweatpants the entire day. Mind your business."
Well,
it's been a while since I've had that thrill of almost pooping my pants. And God damn, it made me feel alive.
Well, that's good. Something else that'll give you a thrill, owning some nice merch from tcthepremix.com. So head on over to tcthepremix.com/merch, or you can check it out in all of our other links at our Linktree account. You can search for it in the URL, your search bar, linktr.ee/tcthepremix. Gives you links to all of our stuff. Yeah. Check out the new merch. Maybe buy yourself something. Like I said, you can check out Twitter off there as well. Give us a follow. When we reach a certain undetermined amount of followers, I'm gonna give away some free merch. So
it's 12 million. I determined it. Keep following, nerds.
Hang with it. But yeah, I think that'll do it for 61, right?
I'll put a pin in 61. Hot. Hugs and kisses on my cats and kittens. Catch you guys in episode 62.
XOXO. See you guys later.
Bye.
See you.